this evening. Thank you for being here. My name is Laura Sisson, and for 20-something years, I was the director of church relations here. My job mainly was to get to know Methodist preachers. I liked doing that. Get to know Methodist churches, and then get to know Methodist youth, and recruit in the church, and ask for money for scholarships for those students. I liked it when the mail came. That was very exciting for me. I also worked with those students who felt the call to ministry here, and that was such a blessing, and several of them are in this audience tonight. So glad to be here. We could be sad, but why should we be sad? We are in a place of joy, of beauty, of fellowship, of healing, of reconciliation, of learning, of prayer, and singing. And I think I could identify many of you who had pizza on this floor after chapel and who stayed up late at night talking in this place even after the lights went out. What a gift this place is for us. We're all filled with memories and blessings of the times that shaped us, that deepened our faith and blessed us. May we now open ourselves to the echoes in this room of voices, of songs, of prayer, of laughter, of learning, of growing together still and always. Welcome.
Good evening.
What a beautiful group of people this is. Thank you all for being here. My name is Kristen Harper. I, for almost 25 years, have helped connect students and faculty to community work outside the gates, and worked with many of you on those really special projects and relationships. I'm also here representing my dad, Mike Harper, who is no longer with us, but was the chaplain here in the late 70s. And I was reflecting on this space earlier this week, thinking about when was the first time that you actually entered this building. And I was probably 6 years old, and I really thought that I could climb those bricks. I only started a little bit. Stuart will tell a story later about somebody who actually succeeded, but this has always been a special place to me. I played around this altar as a child. I remember bringing my first child in my arms when he would not stop crying and walking around the altar, praying for some help, which came. So it's such a special place, and so glad that you are all here as we celebrate our connections tonight. Would you stand and join me in the call to worship? Loving God, tonight our grief and our gratitude mingle together.
For grief can only show up where there has been great love.
Tonight we have come to declare that even in the midst of heartbreak, great is your faithfulness, O God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please remain standing and we'll sing our opening hymn, O God, our help in ages past. I believe there might be a hymnal underneath your seat, and you should plan to share.
all of you, I imagine, hold a lot of special memories. This is the first place I got to inflict my son's tongue in the fourth direction. Just a sign of God to be good. I proposed to my wife in this space. I also met my wife's father in this space. There's so many songs we sing tonight. You all have a favorite of anything you can sing, but I made a little list. So one of the songs that we sang that very first night in chapel, I've never heard of it, because everything we sang tonight was some obscure folk song from somebody that died before I was born. But one of the ones that we sang in the book of Richard that night, I went on to sing in four different continents with those borrowed $20 cars from the Jeep Reserve Flying Project. I sang these words over my babies. And it's the song I want to sing tonight. And you guys sing with me.
I was good news is we had the family in the first meeting, so I had to kind of talk to them and talk to the rest of the crowd. And my wife's not in here anymore to correct me or tell me what I can't say and what I can't say. So there are two things I want to focus on. And the two things are two words and two people. And the two words are thank you. Two words, thank you and thank you. And I just cannot believe the response to people. And when Brian and Stuart told me, we're going to sell out, we're going to have a standing room only, and we're going to have people, we're going to have to turn around. I said, come on, really? I just didn't believe it. But now, look, it's been great. So thank y'all for coming, and just thank you to everyone that's ever had anything to do with the chapel, service learning, or anybody's had anything to do with Birmingham Southern. Just thank you. So I want to tell you about, and I'm so thankful that people would drive, and all, I think all of the living chaplains that were available have come, and they've driven from all over the state to get here. Our family members drove from a lot of different places. And I just think that's so nice to know that they cared enough to do that. So we appreciate it. So I want to tell you about the two people that I give credit for making the chapel happen. And those are two of my uncles. And I got five uncles. I can talk about all of them here the rest of the night, but I'm only going to tell you about two. It's going to be very brief. And those two are Howard Yeilding and Mr. Newman Red Yeilding. And both of them were on the campus in 1918. Does everybody remember 1918? I mean, can you imagine what it was like? So Howard was born in 1899, and in 1916, he was given the opportunity to graduate early from high school if he would enlist in World War I. So he did. He wanted to go overseas. They sent him to South Carolina instead. He was brave. He wanted to fight. So he then went to Vanderbilt for a year, and then his father called him, and his father was Papa, who's on the wall out there, said, son, you need to come home. Help me in the store and go to Birmingham Southern. He says, yes, sir, I'll be right there. Then they had the next brother was born in 1900. That was Newman Red Yeilding. And Newman served in World War I, and he was at Washington Lee University when he got the call that Birmingham Southern was starting here, and his father told him, you're coming home and you're going to Birmingham Southern. So he worked at Yeilding's store. I hope some of you have heard of it. And he said there were just too many Yeildings working there. He had to find something else to do. So Dr. Stavely called him and asked him to be in charge of the money at Birmingham Southern. So he served 39 years, served during the Depression, served during World War II, had a great career. We're very proud of him. And he lived on the campus. He could walk to work. And he had three children. And the three children all went here. And his grandchildren, his great-grandchildren, I think he had like 25 different people in his family that graduated from Birmingham Southern. And I think our family had close to 40 that went here. I didn't say all of them graduated. So back to Uncle Howard. Uncle Howard was a very big man, and I really looked up to him because he was very large. And I want to tell you, I was his favorite nephew. And my choices, I was the favorite. He used to do everything with me, and I won't go into that. But anyway, Uncle Howard had the idea because he visited Notre Dame, saw the chapel at Notre Dame. He went to Washington Lee, saw Lee Chapel. It was his idea to start the chapel, and he left a bequest in his will, not knowing when he was going to die, but, you know, he ended up dying early, and he died in 1964, so he left money to start the chapel. So Uncle Red took the ball with the rest of the brothers, and hard to get money out of Yeilding's. So Uncle Red got the rest of the brothers to put in the money. They got Mr. Thorington to design the building, and I can't wait for y'all to hear what Stuart's going to tell you about the architecture, because Stuart, you have a master understanding all this stuff, and I've heard it before, but I can't repeat it. It's just unbelievable what he knows. So Uncle Howard died in 1964, and the chapel opened in January of 1968. So the family is just so proud that the college has been able to do what it's done with the chapel and the people that have served here, the chaplains, and everybody connected to service learning, and just thank you again to all who've had something to do with it. So I got to tell you one story about the grandfather. And it's so nice to have uncles and grandfathers that you could never have heard anything bad about any of them. Nothing. And I knew all of them. My grandfather, during the Depression, people would bring money to him because they didn't trust the bank. And they would give it to him and say, would you just keep this at Yeilding? When I need the money, I'll come back and get it now. That was a real tribute to him and how people thought of him. And in 1912, his first wife died of tuberculosis and left him with five children. Four boys and one girl, all under 12. So he was a regular at the Methodist conference at Lake Junaluska. So he went, and guess what? He met a Methodist preacher's daughter who was a school teacher, and he talked her into marrying him. And she came to Birmingham and had never been to Birmingham and had never met any of his five children or his mother, who'd been kind of managing the house. So she was the same, and they had two more boys. So that ends up being the six boys and the daughter. So anyway, I just want to tell you again what a pleasure it is to see all of you here. Thank you for coming, and just again, the word tonight is thank you, thank you, thank you for everything everybody's done. Thank you.
Good evening. John Richardson. I was here in the 90s. I recognized so many familiar faces and came back as chaplain from 2007 to 2010. Just want to take a few minutes before we read the Old Testament lesson to share a word of gratitude myself. I think, you know, the thing that has always impressed me about this place is that it was always open. 24/7, 365, you know. And I think I've experienced it just about every hour of the clock at different times. I remember as a new student coming in here in the middle of the night, I just thought it was amazing that, you know, you come and play the piano and have it to yourself. And then sometimes you find other people and strike up conversations. I certainly am amazed, Stuart, that you could get college students to come in here at 6 o'clock in the morning for a 6:30 for a discipline group to talk about, you know, what it meant to live out the life of faith. And I also remember worshiping in here probably 11 o'clock at night during exam week and then going to the cafeteria and having pancakes together. So this is a place that's meant a lot to my family over the years. I think about the story that my parents used to tell. I guess, Richard, if this was dedicated in January of 68, they got married in August of 69, and they would tell that they got engaged out here on this little walkway between the chapel and the planetarium. And the year 2000, I believe, Jasmine and I got engaged in this room as just a sign of how much this room has meant, this place has meant in our lives. So it's with a lot of sadness that I come tonight to think about, you know, that it's not going to be here and be open for us in the same way going forward. But I also know that because it's meant so much to us and we've all been shaped and formed, that we kind of carry that spirit forward into the life that we share, and that in the places and spaces where we find ourselves, that we can live that out in our own ways. So it's with that in mind that we come to the Old Testament lesson tonight, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. This is the word of God for the people of God.
If we haven't met, I'm Julie Holly. I graduated here in 2001, and then in 2015 began my time here as the chaplain until just up to the end of this last year in December. As a student, I was not a regular every Monday night person in the chapel. But I was here often enough that I knew Stuart, and Stuart knew my name, and he would say hello to me outside, so I knew that he knew that I wasn't there when I wasn't in chapel. So I was here just enough to feel guilty when I wasn't here. But in this place, I received the gift of stillness and quietness and calmness that helped sustain me through all of the stress and the chaos of constantly seeking, discerning, the pressure that I've put on myself, the pressure other people put on me, the demands that you feel and experience when you're in college. And I attribute a lot of the peace that I gained here to the tone that Stuart Jackson set in this place. The calmness of his voice, his quiet, reassuring voice, and singing along to, again, songs I didn't know either, with him playing the guitar after each service and hearing from him, I always felt like everything was going to be okay. Now, as the chaplain, I don't think the students here ever thought that I provided quiet and calm. I did not radiate peace or anything. So you see, they're laughing. But all of the laughter that we shared in this space, all of the various serious questions that we addressed, the silliness and just ridiculousness that happened in here, and the honest, direct discussions, sometimes too honest and direct for some people's taste, were an important part both of my formation as an adult, as the chaplain, and I hope for the students who were here as well. And it's a big part of my memories from here. Now, as a student and as a chaplain, things have remained the same in some way in this chapel. One, the smell of this place. Yeah, it's, you walk in and you think, am I in the chapel or my grandmother's basement? It could be either one. But I remember coming back here as the chaplain and smelling this building and thinking, oh, I'm back. And the light, the beauty of the light coming through all of the windows. It changes throughout the day and night, but it still is a familiar sight to me. And of course, the beauty of singing in this space has always been the same. As a student and as a chaplain, that's been one of my favorite times in each service is when we sing and you can hear the voices bouncing off the wall. I feel more connected to God and more connected to the people in the chapel that I'm with every time we sing, especially when we sing a cappella and you can really hear everybody's voices. So I'm thankful for all the time that I've had in this place, and I'm thankful to have the opportunity to lead us in prayer here one more time. So let's pray. Lord, who is present with us in all times and places, we give you thanks for creating us in your image and for working in us even now through the power of your grace to mold us into your faithful and obedient people. Thank you for the communities of faith that have formed us, especially for this place, and for the people connected with it who have shaped our faith, our perspective, our vocations, and our practices, all in the spirit of servant leadership, so that wherever we go, we have the assurance that we are equipped to help create communities of support, care, and learning that reflect all we have gained from our time at Birmingham Southern and here in Yeilding Chapel. We are grateful, Lord, for the beauty and familiarity of the space and the way it comforts us to gather here together. God, we encounter your presence and power in multiple places and experiences throughout our lives. But today, we are particularly aware of and thankful for
the way this chapel opens us to your presence and turns us toward each other as we sing and pray and listen to your word. Today and for years before now, we have brought the joys and concerns of our hearts to lift them to you in this holy place. Lord, hear our voices once again as we name some of our prayers before you now in our hearts. Gracious God, continue to work in and through our lives for your purposes and for the glory of your kingdom. We have received your blessings in this place. Help us to carry these blessings with us and guide us in sharing all that we have received here on this campus with our neighbors throughout your world. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Our chapel services were always included with songs.
I really love the songs. And we would usually sing the refrain. I would usually compose the refrain myself. And it was dictated by the three chords that I knew at the time. So once they fit, I was the composer.
Our psalm is 23. It's found on page 754 in your hymnals. And John and Jack will lead this, and then we'll sing the refrain. That's where it says R. Here it is.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
Try that.
Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
Spread your voices out into the harmonies.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures.
Leads
me beside still waters, restores my life. Leads me in right paths for the sake of the Lord's name.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil.
For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
The Lord is my shepherd.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for as long as I live.
Lord is my shepherd. I shall.
Y'all do sound great. My name is Jack Hennen. I was the chaplain here from 2011 until 2015. Some may have called me General Krulak's court jester. I did not meet my wife in this space. Didn't meet her dad. I actually was not a student at Birmingham Southern. I'm from a small town in Alabama, like a lot of the students who came to this place. And from being from a small town, my brother came to Birmingham Southern, found his way here, graduated in 2001, And in his time at Birmingham Southern, it was obvious that hope happened for my brother. That BSC was the kind of place where he could grow in his faith here at Yeilding Chapel. It was the kind of place where he could grow as a person. It's the kind of place where my brother was encouraged and hope happened for him here at Birmingham Southern. I want to add those two words to Richard's words. Hope happens. Now, I didn't want to be Jerry's little brother for another 4 years, so I didn't come as a student to Birmingham Southern. I went to another college. I've been in ministry for a while, and 8 years later, after my brother was here, I came to be the chaplain. And I got here on campus, and I was meeting people, and I was talking to people, and I was getting to know the faculty and getting to know the staff, and I met one particular individual, a gentleman named Fred Ash, who is an English professor here. And I said, "Hi, my name is Jack Hennen." And he goes, "Hennen, Hennen. You're Jerry Hennen's little brother, aren't you?" Yes, 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 I am. And for many wonderful years, I got to be here at Birmingham Southern and got to share hope even in this place and have hope shared with me. I got to announce to a bunch of college students that me and my wife were experiencing, she was pregnant, we were going to have our first child. And they were more excited here than all of the UMWs combined. Right? You just do not know how fantastic it was to be in Yeilding Chapel and for those screams to echo to the heavens. I have been able to experience hope in this place. I've gotten to enjoy being Jerry's little brother. And I really think it's a beautiful thing that in a place like Birmingham Southern, we could all figure out how to be someone's little brother, someone's little sister. You are known at Birmingham Southern. And it is, to me, a bit of a sad thing that my children won't be able to come to BSC, not in the same way that my brother came or that I came, and to be able to be Jerry's niece or nephew. But hope still happens. In fact, I bet that at some point in my children's lives, at some point in your families and in your communities, whether it's in Birmingham or in Pensacola where I live now, it's much flatter there, by the way, someone is going to know you because of this place. You are going to know someone else because of this place. Hope still happens. And that's why we're going to read the Gospel of Luke. I invite you to stand as we read together. Or as I read. From the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19, verses 29 through 40. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, order your disciples to stop.' And he answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out.'" The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's remain standing for our litany.
As we share in a litany of leave-taking, we invite you to join us with the responses as they are printed in your booklet. Holy and gracious God, thank you for our time in Yeilding Chapel. Thank you for those who funded its construction, those who designed it, and for all those who laid bricks, made stained glass, cut marble, shaped the wood, and laid the infrastructure so we could have light, water, and air. We thank you, God, for all those at this college who have been faithful stewards of this building. Loving God, we thank you that your word has long been proclaimed within this hallowed place. We thank you for all who have made this holy ground possible. Holy and gracious God,
we give you thanks. For 57 years, students, faculty, and staff have prayed their prayers, have sung your praises here, and your spirit has blessed countless worshipers. This space has held holy conversations and holier silences, late nights of singing and early mornings of devotion. Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks.
We thank you that in a time of transition, this place was a refuge. This has been a place of peace in the midst of pilgrimage, a reminder of your unwavering faithfulness in the midst of uncertainty. We have been fed here, finding sustenance for our journey as we celebrated the Lord's Supper together at this table. Holy and gracious God,
we give you thanks.
This has been a thin place, Lord, where people have heard your voice. From within these walls, countless many have gone out to serve you in the world. We give you thanks for all who have discovered faith here, or rediscovered a faith that they believed had been lost. The transformation that began within these walls has changed the world for the better. Holy and gracious God,
we give you thanks.
We ask that those who come behind us may also find in this chapel a place of grace and peace. We trust that even in the grief of our beloved college's ending, you are at work to bring forth life. As we go now from this house into a further journey of faith, we give you thanks, O God,
through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
This is like a time warp, isn't it? Thank you for coming. I don't want to be here. I need to be here. You don't want to be here. Not for this. But we need to be here because we need each other. I thank you for all of you who've come so many miles to be here tonight. And if anyone here was drugged here by an overly enthusiastic alum, thank you especially for coming. I'm so grateful and still feel really privileged to be with the chaplains that have been, well, I guess we're the five living chaplains that have been here since 79. Their skill, their intelligence, their faith, their devotion, their love for you and this college is really inspiring. I'm grateful to Sue Powell, who's here tonight. for more than 30 years. She was the assistant in the chapel. She did everything, including removing snakes from her desk. The first organist I really met up close was Rick Phillips. Scared me a little bit. This man has the energy. We could run this chapel on this energy of this man. But it's not matched, but his intelligence and his discipline and his talent are beyond words. Same with John Richardson, who not only is clergy, he's also RN, or an a registered nurse, and an organist, and a pianist, and a father, and a husband. He's very thin. The road from grief to gratitude has no shortcuts. There are valleys and hilltops. The only thing that can help us on that journey is to travel with those who are going in the same direction. That's why it's so good that we're here and together tonight. All the gospel writers record that after Jesus set his face towards Jerusalem, his teachings took on an intensity and power that was different than the agricultural family stories and parables prior to that. He had begun to tell his followers many times, "We're going to Jerusalem. I will be arrested. I will be tried unjustly. I will be murdered." They didn't understand this. They couldn't understand it. But the government and the religious leaders of the day, who were threatened by his message and presence, hatched a plan so that the political leaders of that day could try to end him and his movement. Well, LOL. Luke reports that as Jesus approaches Jerusalem, the commotion of the crowds concerning some of the religious leaders, he writes, "Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, tell your disciples to stop yelling.' And he answered, 'I'll tell you this, if they are silenced, the stones will shout out.'" We are sitting in a room where the stones still speak. These stones, this marble, this glass, this metal still speaks. I know every building makes a statement. That's the artistry of architecture. The statement that Yeilding Chapel makes is a sentence in which God is the subject, love is the verb, and we and all creation are the objects. It takes a lot of pressure off a student when they can come into a space where they are not the required focus of attention. God is the subject here, not us. This sentence is shouted in symbolic language. It's the symbolic language of the church. Symbolic language invites us not only to look at the symbol, but to look through it to see what it represents. This building does that about as well as any I know. The first thing people generally notice when they walk in is that this building is round. I think when it comes to religion and faith and spirituality, especially at a college, it's important to be in a place where one cannot be backed into a corner. No corners. This accomplishes that without saying a word. Most people, when they enter the first time, also look up. That's the point, isn't it? And if you're a college student that experiences the normal confusions of college life about what you're going to do, who you're going to be, who you're going to be with, you'll need a place where you can look up. A round building has a way of gathering people, gathering oneself. This is a peaceful place. When you work and study at a college, life can quickly become pretty scattered. So to have a building where you can go and be gathered is very important. It's the only building on campus that I know of where no one gets a grade. Some of the other languages that it speaks of, there are 12 arches in this building, these big arches here, 12 arches. 12 tribes, 12 disciples. I don't think it's the 12 zodiac signs, but I think it's the disciples, because in the altar table, those arches are reproduced, wherein is carved the symbol for each of the 12 disciples. You can see it when we're walking around. The windows stand out, don't they? During the day, the hues in this room change as the sun, well, as the earth moves around the sun. Basically, sort of south, west, north, east. The top center panel of each window defines the theme. It's made in colors of the four liturgical colors of the Christian church. Each of the top expressions of the top panels is one expression that Christians think of God. God the Creator and the descending hand of creation. God the Son. You'll remember your Greek, won't you? That ichthus, the Greek word for fish, is the symbol in the early church. Because when people met on the roads and they wanted to know if you're a Christian or not, they would be standing talking and they would just take their toe and they would just do that. And if the person they were talking to saw that and was a Christian, they would complete it. So it made. And ever since, that's been the symbol for God the Son, God the Spirit, the descending dove, the Holy Spirit, and God the Trinity. In the bottom left-hand corner is the symbol for each of the four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And then every other symbol there has to do with those gospels. Each one has meaning. The black in the, you can't see it now, it's brown, sort of. Maybe in the blue window you can, maybe in the green. You can see the black around some of the crosses. That's not glass, that's brick dirt. Mr. Jim Thorington, who designed this, wanted the outsides of the chapel to be the same color in the windows as it was in the brick, so he ordered another pallet of bricks, and they ground it up, and that became the dust that they used to pack into the stained glass windows to make them black. The glass is done by what I'm told the refracted glass technique. It's basically, it looks like that green, those greens and blues are different colors, but actually it's the same piece of glass. They would take hammers and beat the glass so that as it broke up, some places would be thinner and the light would come through faster. Some places would be thicker and the light would go slower and be deeper. Oh. Not unlike us, we're of different thicknesses. I don't mean that body shaming. I mean, I'm talking about here. Like in the Bible that says, we are stiff-necked, thick-headed people. In the center is the cross, hanging there for 57 years. The central reality in Jesus' life, on the one side, his birth and incarnation, on the other side, his resurrection, in the middle, the cross. So it hangs in the center of the room. The metal strips of the mobile hang symbolize the descending spirit. The oculus in the center of the roof in Christian churches is also called the Holy Ghost hole. Oculi were common in Greek and Roman temples, but in the 16th century, German churches cut things and they would take up straw, and on the day of Pentecost, which was yesterday, they would take up straw and they'd light it on fire and throw it into the congregation for the descending, you know, tongues of fire. Yeah. But this tended to put the congregation on fire externally rather than internally, so it was dropped, and rose petals were substituted. I've been happy the metal strips were there, and happier the fish wire has held up the cross. The bench for the clergy is separate from the congregation, and yet the same level. We all sit at the same level here. The only thing that is raised here is the altar. From this altar, we read the scriptures, the prayers are said, and the sacraments are offered. From this altar, babies have been blessed. Couples have become engaged. Couples have pledged their love to each other in weddings. Words have been offered in mourning after the death in a family. It's the one place where you can stand in this room and whisper and be heard all the way around. The bricks are set in a pattern to make the walls curve, but also to create shadows so that when you're sitting over here, that wall looks closer to you than it actually is, and vice versa over here, that looks closer. And for some of you who quit listening a while ago, you're thinking, wonder how hard it would be to climb that thing. Like, where's Chris? Yeah, right there. Yeah. Luke records that after Jesus told them that the stones would speak if the people were silenced, he was up on a mountain, he looked over the valley and into Jerusalem. And he started crying. Oh, Jerusalem, he said, if only you had heard, if only you had listened. Well, we feel like weeping. We have wept. We walk this hilltop and inevitably sink into the if onlys. If only they had, if only I had. Of course, there'd be one thing worse than feeling that grief, it would be if you were having to feel it by yourself. But we feel it in community. And whether you know it or not, many of you do know that our leaders have done every single thing they could do over and over again. It's like having the lifeboat out for you on a sinking ship or a ship that's in trouble and saying, come on, and then having it jerked away from you. Our leaders began years ago realizing the crisis was coming and worked overtime to find a way forward. Letters were written, calls were made, donations were requested, and they came. They came. We were on the way. We have all lobbied and written, called our state leaders. We've gone to see them. We've begged. We've tried reasoning. Every possible avenue, every possible alleyway was gone down to try to find a way forward. But we've come to the time when it's time to let it go. We tried our best. The leaders here did all they could. And even when it was clear that it would not be a clear pathway, our leaders focused on the students and the faculty and staff before they talked about the property. Maybe these stones can also say the most often repeated commandment in Scripture, which is, don't worry. Don't be afraid. There will be another day. A reminder that with faith, with the assurance of things hoped for, with the conviction of things not seen, we can go forward knowing that the ending is a new beginning. As I see it, Birmingham Southern is one of the colleges that is an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual idea. That the function of education is to draw out of a person the best and noblest parts of our humanity. It's a place that teaches how to think, not what to think. It teaches and models that education is a privilege. And response to that privilege is service to others and to the creation we all share. We didn't invent this idea. It's older than we are. And I believe it's our responsibility to continue to promote this idea, this way of learning in families and communities, wherever we are, that an education that challenges the mind and embraces the heart will not vanish from our state. No matter what happens next, let us not be guided by our cynicism or retribution or revenge or our anger. Rather, let us be guided by a force greater than all of those. That love will guide us, that peace has tried us, that hope inside us will lead the way. If you cannot
Hi, everyone. My name is Lindsay Hitchcock, and I'm a current senior at Birmingham Southern, and I'm so grateful to be here with you all today. I remember the first time I walked into the Religious Life office at Birmingham Southern, my very first week of college. I saw the blessing from Numbers on the wall. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. And I thought that was really cool because that was the blessing that my Methodist youth group would say growing up. And then later that week, I was in my first college friend Molly's room up on the third floor of Maggie, and she had a pillow that also had that same verse on it. And I thought, how cool and special that this verse that my youth group, and only my youth group, says is all over this campus just for me. I asked Molly about the pillow, though, and she informed me that her youth group also says this, and I have since come to learn that pretty much every Methodist youth group uses this blessing. And I hate to say it, but my poor, sweet 18-year-old heart was kind of sad to find out that something that I had thought was special just for me ended up being much bigger. Now, though, at the ripe age of 22, which I say with sarcasm, but I think we all understand the pretty intense growth spurt that happens in college, especially at Birmingham Southern, I now understand that shared experiences are so much more special than private ones. And I am so grateful for all of the shared experiences that all of us in this room together have across all the years and all the generations. I'm grateful that we all know this chapel and have experienced love and community and God's presence within it. I'm grateful for all the other memories that we share here at BSC. And I am heartbroken that more people will not get to share these memories with us. Yet I find comfort in knowing that this is grief that I don't have to take on alone and that we can also all share together. So as you go forward from this place, know that the responsibility of remembering and honoring Birmingham Southern and the work God has done here is not something that you can do alone, but something that we may all do together. Because as long as we continue sharing stories and memories and lessons and blessings, the work that God has done here continues. So at this time, I invite you to receive this benediction, and if you know the words, to please say it with me. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace. Thank you.